Good evening. Welcome to the Port Charlotte Church of Christ Midweek Bible Study. We're glad that you're with us either on Facebook or YouTube tonight. Will you please bow with me as we go to our Heavenly Father in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for this time that we can study from your word. And Father, we're so thankful that we're able to come across the Facebook and YouTube and to be able to study from your word. And Father, bless us tonight as we go into this study. Help us, Father, to grow closer to you. May we take what we've learned today and tonight and apply it to our everyday lives. May we always be good stewards, not only of the things that you allow us to have upon this earth, but also especially your word. Father, bless our sick, those that need our prayers. Bless our congregation, our leaders, our elders, our deacons, as decisions are made. We're grateful, Father, for the physical blessings that you give us, but we're also far more grateful, Father, for the spiritual blessings we have through your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, to be good examples to those that we come around each and every day. Help us, Father, to always put you first in our lives. Forgive us of our wrongdoings when we fall short. Strengthen us, Father, that we might not commit those sins again. Again, we're grateful for this time that we have. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And if you would, get your Bibles, turn to the book of Proverbs. We'll be there in just a few moments. We'll begin in about chapter 5. And before we start, we just want to remind everybody, and we're excited to announce that we are coming back to services starting this coming Sunday. That's May 10th. We're going to have two services, one at 9:30 a.m. and another one at 11 a.m. If you have not called the office yet or let us know which service you would prefer to attend, please do that as soon as you can. Seats are limited due to the restrictions with the social distancing, but we are so excited. We're looking forward to seeing as many of you as possible this coming Sunday. Remember, if you have immune issues or you don't feel comfortable coming back just yet, that is fine. We are still going to be doing our live streams on Sunday morning at 10:30 and also a midweek class like this on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. As we begin tonight, if you remember a couple Wednesday nights ago, I did a study on the steps to success in the book of Proverbs as we looked at the wise man Solomon as he tells his son and gives his son some advice on how can you assure, how can you be guaranteed a life of success. And we talked about 10 points that day as we studied for that. Tonight I'm going to kind of look at the opposite side, because after Solomon discusses the success, the guarantee for success with his young son, then he goes into chapters 5, 6, and 7, warning his son, telling his son, just as easy as a guarantee for success, if you do certain things that you're not supposed to do, basically, young man, you're going to be guaranteed a life of failure. Now, nobody wants to be a failure. I don't know of anybody who says, you know what, I want to be a failure. It's a little bit like the little boy who came home one day after playing baseball, and he's in his uniform, and he walks in the back door, and his mother said, well, you know, how did baseball go tonight? And the little boy kind of grumbled and said, not good at all. I struck out 3 times. And the mother said, you know, that's okay, you know, son, that's just part of the game. And the little boy said, no, it's not, Mom, it's T-ball. Well, you know what? We all don't like to fail. There's just something about a failure. And as we think about our lives, we might have said from time to time, you know what, I wish I had listened to some advice that somebody had given me, or, you know, if I had it to do all over again, I might have done this or that. There's just something about good advice. And what we're going to look at tonight is some really good advice that Solomon is giving to his son that we can also apply to our lives and hopefully live a life of success and not a life of failure. Somebody once said that good advice is what your own kids disregard, but save it to give to their kids. And I guess that may be kind of true. Sometimes we don't want to take good advice, but let's take this advice. Well, Proverbs here, as we know, as we talked about a couple weeks ago, Proverbs deals with the practical affairs of life. It really goes into a lot of the value of wisdom, especially of godly wisdom, of obeying God, doing what is right. But it also tells us there's a folly of not obeying, and you find yourself in failure. So we're going to start again in Proverbs chapter 5. We're going to begin with some things we see beginning in verse 1, and we're going to the reading probably goes to about verse 23 at the end of chapter 5. For time's sake, we're not going to go into that, but I really challenge you to read that. But here, as Solomon introduces, I guess we might call this a recipe for certain failure, he goes into the number one, and that is to commit adultery and ruin a good marriage, or if you will, get involved with the strange woman, as is talked about. Well, we know from the book of Galatians chapter 6, 7, and 8, even in the New Testament, we're told over and over again that failure or success is the result of our own choices. You know, sometimes we just make the wrong choice. And what Solomon is warning his son here is, don't do this. And for the first few verses, he really urges his son there, verses 1 and 2. You know what? Attend to my wisdom. Listen to what I am telling you. Incline your ear to my understanding. Young man, listen to what I'm saying. You need to preserve discretion. And that's really true. He calls this a strange woman. Solomon describes her as a seducer in verses 3 through 6, with examples like lips smooth as a drop of honey or a mouth smoother than oil. Solomon is saying, you know what? She doesn't belong to you, and neither is she available to you. We know even in life today, so many marriages are destroyed because of adultery between one or more of the spouses. And then about verses 15 through 23, Solomon calls for faithfulness. This is what you have to do. You know, drink from your own well. Rejoice in the wife of your youth. Basically, be faithful. And you have to be very, very careful. So the very first thing he says is, be very careful. The deceptive, strange woman can pull you in, and it can ruin your life. Well, let's go to chapter 6 for number 2. Number 2, Solomon warns the young man in verses 1 through 5 of chapter 6, don't make bad money decisions. Don't make bad financial decisions. Don't enter into a bad financial obligation with someone. We've probably all known people, maybe you've even, or I've even fallen into that sometimes. You loan money to someone, or you get involved guaranteeing a loan, and you find yourself in the end stuck with that bill. Maybe they don't pay it, or you don't get paid back. That often happens. Verses 1 through 5, Solomon says, don't become surety. That idea, don't be responsible for a neighbor's debt. Worry about your own. Be responsible. Take care of your own family. Get out of it if you get yourself in it, because there's always going to be folks that want to take advantage of you. So we kind of understand that idea. Be careful. You know, as we often say, money is hard to come by, and there's always somebody there that's going to grab it or take it away from us, and we need to be careful about that. So Solomon's very wise here. You know, watch what you do with your own money. Well, number 3, also in chapter 6, about verses 6 through 11, as you read there, Solomon simply warns his son, don't be lazy. You know, often in the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, there's verse after verse discussing how God feels about work. We're told to work with the sweat of our brow. We're told that work is honorable. We know that, as the New Testament says, if a man won't work, neither shall he eat. The New Testament even calls somebody who doesn't take care of his family worse than an infidel. So we know there are many verses that talk about that. So Solomon says, don't be lazy. Do an honest day's work for an honest day's pay, as we said. You be very diligent, verses 6 through 8. Be diligent in your work. Don't be a sluggard. Don't love sleep more than you love work. In verse 6, it says, he tells us, if you're even tempted to be lazy or be a sluggard, look at the ant. And we all understand the idea of how ants work, and they move fast, and they do all kinds of things as they work together, and they're very industrious. And he says, you know, look to that. Look to be more like the ant. Don't be lazy. You're going to not, you know, you're going to fall into financial ruin. You'll never get ahead. And indeed, we've all heard that as, you know, as we were younger from our parents or grandparents. Make sure you work hard. Money Magazine study in 2018 said physical inactivity in America is costing people a lot more than their slim fit jeans. And I think that's true. They say globally we lose $67.5 billion, that's with a B, dollars every year due to just idleness and laziness. So this is really, really true what Solomon is warning his son. Don't be lazy. We understand that. Well, also in chapter 6, number 4, he says, be untrustworthy. The idea is, you know what, just you be an untrustworthy person, Solomon says, and you have set your life up for certain failure. Look at verses 12 through 15. There Solomon calls a type of person that would be untrustworthy, worthless. Now, can you imagine being called worthless? We wouldn't like that. He also goes on to describe a person like that as a man of iniquity, that he walks with a perverse mouth. You don't trust anything that he says or even does, and that he devises evil continually, almost like a person that would just spend their days and their nights just concocting more evil. And Solomon is saying, if you do that, then your whole life will be characterized not by honesty, but by dishonesty. And if you do that, you will set yourself up for a life of failure. Well, let's go on to number 5. Number 5, Solomon goes into a discourse with his young man in chapter 6, verses 16 through 19. Some really heavy stuff here. And he says, you just commit the sins. You do the things that that God says he personally hates. The Bible tells us very clearly there are certain things in life that God hates, that God calls an abomination to him. And Solomon is saying, you get involved in those things, you've set yourself up for certain failure. Well, what are some of the things that he says? Well, number one, in verse 17, a proud look. Somebody whose heart is full of pride, you might call him or her an arrogant person. Now, that type of person will never admit that they've sinned. They're never going to ask anybody for forgiveness. They're just that type of person. And in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 5, it says, God resists the proud. He resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. God has always rewarded humbleness. He always expects you and I, as children of his, to have humbleness as part of our life. Well, he also says in verse 17, a lying tongue. We've kind of talked about that, about an untrustworthy person earlier, but the world that we live in is full of dishonesty. It seems like you can't believe anybody anymore. I remember my grandfather years ago said, you know, as a young man, he could walk into a bank with a handshake, and you just borrowed the money. And you borrowed it on your name and your promise to pay that money back. And you would go and pay the banker back after the crops were in or whatever you borrowed it for. Well, nowadays, that wouldn't even work. You have to sign 1,000 pieces of paper now almost. And still yet, they don't even really trust you to borrow money. And it's just the way the world that we live in. So many people are dishonest. We just expect it. Don't be dishonest. Well, he also says God hates those who shed innocent blood. God has always valued human life. God has always hated violence. And he's telling us again, don't shed innocent blood. Well, number 4, don't have a wicked heart in verse 15. Again, a heart that devises imaginations or wicked imaginations. That type of lifestyle, again, that you just sit and you just devise more evil to do. I can't imagine, but there are folks like that. A rebellious heart, really, that a person that always finds ways
to do what is wrong, always looking for the wages to do evil. That is a certain recipe for failure. You see, when we have a wicked heart and we just continually devise wicked, what is our minds and our hearts full of? It's full of wickedness. And your heart will develop that attitude that the only thing that matters is me. It doesn't matter what God says. Well, he also says there in verse 17 and 18, feet that swiftly run to mischief. They're just people. We've all known people that just love it. They love to run to mischief. If it's something going wrong, they're going to be right there. But the Bible tells us over and over again, it is so easy just to do good. And Solomon's giving wise counsel here to his son. Well, look at 19. Also, something else that God hates is a false witness that speaks lies. That idea that we don't like people that perjure themselves in our court systems here. I mean, that hurts the innocent person and it rewards the guilty. Now, the same thing is true. The worst part is when we lie, we're lying against God. God is always expects his children, those that are successful in life, to always be truthful. Well, how about finally those that sow discord among the brethren in verse 19? That idea that somebody who causes problems in the Lord's church, somebody who would divide just out of the joy of dividing and getting involved in arguments and things. That's not the way God wants us to be. He wants his brethren to love one another. 1 John chapter 3, 14 and 15. That should be our badge that we wear, right? To love one another and appreciate one another. It's the devil that wants things to be destroyed and for us to lose harmony. Well, let's go on though. Also, that idea that don't lust for temptation, number 6. If you want to make certain failure of your life, then don't lust for temptation. That's in chapter 6, verses 20 through 35. Solomon says, heed my advice. Guard your heart against temptation. And realize if you sin, whether it's immorality, whatever it might be, that it's not going to be overlooked. And the sobering part of this for the young man that he's speaking to, also for us today, is that idea that we will give an account someday in judgment. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 13. We're going to give an account for everything that we've done. So Solomon says, listen to wise counsel. And I want to really remind all of us of this, because when we think about doing some of these things and not doing certain things, I've heard people say, you know what, God's just telling us that we can't have any fun in life. That, you know, if I want to be a Christian, God's taking all the joy out of life and he's telling me all the fun stuff I can't do. But we need to look at it a different way. That God's commands are not meant to remove fun from our life. It's not. He wants us to have lives full of enjoyment, but rather his commands are to illuminate our path to a successful life. In this life, but more importantly, in the life to come, in all of eternity. And that's why we need to look at it. So make sure that we don't look for or lust for temptation. Well, finally, and I think this is interesting too, but pretty simple. He says in chapter 7, verses 1 through 9, he says, young man, don't go to places where sin is committed. Now, as a Christian, we'd all have to say, there are just certain places that I know that I should not go. There are certain places I don't want to go because I know that there are sins being committed there. Or I know that perhaps I'm weak in certain areas, so I know I can't go to certain areas. It takes a high degree of wisdom, of godly wisdom, to keep us oftentimes from those places. And Solomon's saying, there are just certain places you don't go. If you want to live a successful life, there are places you don't want to go. If you want to set your life up for total failure, then by all means, you go to those places where sin's committed, and you'll just be right in the middle of it. We're often seduced. We fall to temptation when we find ourselves at the wrong place at the wrong time. It just happens. And that's what he's saying in verses 8 and 9 there in chapter 7. Don't put yourself in a vulnerable position. Now, just to wrap up the study, I mean, simply, what is he saying to the young man? What can we take from these seven simple steps tonight that I can apply to my life? Because I don't want to be a failure, and I know you don't want to either. Well, he's saying always the best choice is to choose godly wisdom, to always choose what we ought to be doing in regards to what does God's will tell me to do. Right at the beginning of Proverbs in chapter 1 and verse 7, it tells us right there, the fear of Jehovah is the beginning of knowledge, but the foolish despise wisdom and instruction. He's saying, don't despise wisdom, but cleave to it. Have every part of our lives filled with that idea of godly wisdom. Well, as we close tonight, I think about success and I think about failure in life. I mean, it's very sad to be a failure here in this life. I mean, we don't want that. It's great to be a success. But when God speaks about success and failure in His Word, what we really want to look at is, you know what, the real victory or real defeat is going to come someday. In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, when you read verses 50 through 58 there, one of the verses there will say, thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. That idea, the ultimate victory will be one day when we stand before God in judgment and we're judged in such a way that He says, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter in to the joys that have been prepared for you. And on the other side, real failure, and a sad real failure is going to be on that same day as He divides those in one way to the other. And the other way, He's going to say, you know what, depart from me. I never knew you, into everlasting punishment. That's where real defeat happens. And that's where it is so sad. You see, failure is not fatal if we do something about it. If we learn from our failures, we admit them, and we go to God and we ask for forgiveness, or we're obedient to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I guess tonight, as we end our study, I want us all to, as we read, hopefully the rest of this week, Proverbs 5, 6, and 7, and we look for what Solomon warns his son about, that will remove all of those things, those bad choices from our lives. And we'll say, you know what, I want to be a success, and I want to do those steps to success, not only for this life, which will make this life much more enjoyable, but especially for all eternity, as He promises us joy beyond compare. Thank you for being with us tonight. We appreciate you being with us. We look forward to being with you Sunday morning at 10:30, but also we'll be here at the building at 9:30 and again at 11 a.m. at the address that you find here as we go back to worshiping God. If you would please bow your heads as we close in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the time that You've given us to study briefly here from Your Word. And we just are so grateful, Father, for the wisdom that we find in Your Word, for all the not only warnings that we need to heed, but also, Father, all the things that You tell us to cleave to and to that we know, Father, that not only if we do those things, that we will have a happy life upon this earth, successful life, much joy, but also, Father, that we can look forward to even more joy as we look towards eternity with You. And Father, our minds and hearts now go to those that are sick, those that are on beds of affliction this night, those that are having treatments, maybe awaiting surgeries, those who might even be suffering from the virus that is all over our country now. And we just pray, Father, that as we lift each and every one up to You, that You would be with them, comfort them, and heal them if it's Your will. We also, Father, are so grateful for the church. We're grateful, Father, for the congregation here at Port Charlotte. We ask, Father, Your blessings upon us as we resume meeting each and every Lord's Day. And we're looking forward to that, Father, and we're so grateful for the blessing of being able to do that this coming Sunday. Again, Father, we ask that You would bless us through the rest of this week. Encourage us, help us, give us strength, Father, as we enter into the world, and that we always put our hearts and minds towards You. Father, we love You. We're so grateful for all that You do, especially Your Son and our Savior, Christ Jesus.
the salvation that we find through his wonderful sacrifice on that cross. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.